In this lecture, we're going to do a recap of incident management. So incident management is the monitoring and detection of security events on our systems. And then how do we react to those events? First off, we looked at the definitions. An event is an observable change in a state. It's not positive, it is not negative, it is just something happened. That can be traffic on a specific networking segment. It can be a server powering on. Something changed in our environment. That is an event. Then we had an alert. That is a triggered warning when certain events happen. This is something we pre-configure. That could be networking traffic on this segment has above 75% bandwidth utilization for more than 2 minutes, or a server that uses above a certain threshold of memory for a certain amount of time. Then we had an incident, and that is when multiple adverse events happen on our systems or network. We had a problem. That is an incident with an unknown cause. So with this, obviously, we need to fix it, but we also need to understand how and why did this happen. Then we had an inconvenience or a non-disaster. Those are things in our environment that are down or broken, but since we have redundancy, the end user will not notice. That could be the server that had the 3 disks in a RAID setup. If one disk fails, the other two are perfectly fine on their own. We obviously need to replace that disk as soon as we know it has failed, but there's no negative impact on the server or the traffic, the end user doesn't notice. Then we had an emergency. This is urgent. We need to do something about this right now. And many times this has to do with the protection of property or life. The next one up was a disaster. That is our entire facility being down or unusable for 24 hours or more. And that was the one that could be a snowstorm. It could of course be something more dramatic, but if our team can't get to work and they can't work from home, we are unable to function for 24 hours or more. And then as the last definition, we had a catastrophe. That was where our entire facility was destroyed. Then we talked about NIST 800-61. That was the one that focused on the incident response lifecycle. We talked about the cyber incident response team, where we had to have that mix of senior management, the incident manager, the technical lead and teams, IT security, PR, HR, legal, and then after the fact, we might need an IT auditor and or a financial auditor. Because to handle the incident right, to make it less impactful, we need the right people. And then we finished out by talking about the 8 steps of incident management. We start with preparation. Just like with any good project here, again, we need the right stakeholders. We need to understand what exactly are we protecting, what is in scope and what is out of scope. Then we do detection. We realize we've been attacked. We respond, and that is when the incident response team starts working on the systems and we try to contain the damage as much as possible. Then we move into mitigation. Here we understand what happened, and since we have that clear understanding of what happened, we can both clean and restore the systems back into full operation. And we do that in recovery. But if we're not completely sure, it might a lot of times be smart to build a completely new server, load the operating system, the applications, and then only restore the data from the applications that we have on that server. Because a lot of the malware is going to be hidden on the system, so we do a clean install and just import the data. And this is way easier to do now than it was maybe 10 years ago. In many places, we don't use physical servers anymore. The servers are virtual. We still use a physical server chassis, but it is basically a giant, super powerful computer that we then segment into hundreds and hundreds of servers. The chassis is maybe the size of 5 regular servers, maybe 10, but it can hold hundreds, if not thousands of servers. So when we do the restore, we don't have to go out, find a physical standalone server, configure it, add the operating system, the applications. We can do all that remotely. We don't have to be physically in the data center. We can do it from our desk or we can do it from home. And here we need to make sure that we have that good backup. We need to make sure that what we are restoring with is not infected as well. If the vulnerability that caused the incident is well known, well then we need to find if there's a patch for it. If it is not a known vulnerability, well then we need to see what can we do to mitigate the damages from this vulnerability to make sure even with the vulnerability present, we are still secure. We then move into reporting. But really, we start reporting all the way from detection to lessons learned. Because if we do it after the fact, if we start way later in the process, we're not really going to remember clearly what happened earlier. And in reporting, we have 2 main areas, the technical part and the non-technical part. The IT team handles the technical part. The other teams that are still involved in the incident, that could be HR, legal, human resources, senior management, they handle all the non-technical parts. Then we do recovery. That is where we very carefully restore the system or systems into their operational status. We can either put them in a sandbox or a honey net, but if they are critical systems, it's unlikely we're going to have time for that. We might have to push them into production as soon as they are ready, but then we watch them very, very carefully for an extended period of time. We need to make sure that nothing was left behind by the attacker that they can use to access the systems. Then we have remediation. That's the one where we have fixed all the systems that were attacked, but we need to fix the same flaw on all the other systems we have to make sure they're not vulnerable as well. And then as the last part of incident management, we have lessons learned. Here, we figure out what worked well, what did not work well, what can we do better next time, and we do that in-depth root cause analysis. So we can be very clear on what happened, how did it happen, and was there anything else we could have put in place, some sort of mitigation, that even with this vulnerability being present, we could have stopped the attack. That was the one where I used the example of we locked all the windows, but even with the windows being open, we could have used a motion sensor that could have alerted us if someone was in the building. And with that, we are done with incident management. I hope this has helped you get a better understanding of incident management and the incident management lifecycle. Thank you for being here, and I will see you in the next lecture.